Welcome back once again to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I am, as always, Chat Show. Who the hell are you and what do you want? Yes, it's a new signature of mine. Do you like it? That's how I start the show now. I've been away that long, or so it feels, that I would reinvent how to do anything on this show. I want to start by thanking Sam Levine for sitting in for me in my absence. I know some of you may know that I was in Bulgaria. You're not buffering.
You smirked in that one.
I did. It doesn't work if my face moves.
Or if I talk about it.
I was in Bulgaria. We'll get to that in a second. First off, though, I want to welcome Jamie back to the to her seat and explain why Sam Levine has been replaced by a finer version, a better Jew.
That's probably true.
Yeah. No, we miss Sammy. He's in the Austin, Texas, or Texarkana, doing a web series. And the very lovely Corey Levin, not to be confused with Levine. Why'd they drop the E? Any idea?
It's an Ellis Island thing. Sloppy.
They put an
Ellis
E on.
Needed the E for their own name.
Yeah. Ellis. It was just Ellis Island first. Yeah.
And Jamie?
Yes.
Were you here? You were here for
Mae
Whitman.
Yeah, I've been here.
I watched from Bulgaria, and we did a funky thing where I.
Yeah, you FaceTimed with
us. We FaceTimed from Bulgaria. It was so meta.
Yeah.
But then there was this crazy, like, 7-minute delay, which no one could understand.
The Bulgarian delay.
The Bulgarian delay, we came to call it, because everyone thought that the internet was live. Turns out not so much. You have to go through. A vortex of 1993.
Oh, so what you were watching was 7 minutes. Like, you were watching like 7 minutes. Okay.
Gotcha. And we didn't realize it until we tried to FaceTime, and then it took 7 minutes for it to come up on the show. Sorry that took so long.
Also, I'm sure everyone's fascinated by this right now.
Well, I'm going to get to the Bulgarian story and my directing of motion pictures. But first, also, I should, you know what, I'll save that for our guest because there's a tie-in. I was going to congratulate my new television co-star, Jane Lynch, on her Emmy victory, which I've still not done.
Doesn't count.
Nope. That was not sincere. We're coming to you live from the West Side Comedy Theater in the Santa Monica, California area. If you're ever in the area and you want to see one of the better improv or stand-up shows, this is the joint for you. I want to thank Sean Casey and the gang here at West Side Comedy Theater for being our home. And do you watch us on the YouTube? Do you subscribe? Have you written a review? What the fuck is your problem? You're dialing us up on the earwolf because you can't stand to look at us. How do you watch the show? Write to us, please. kpcsfanmail@gmail.com. KPCS, as in Kevin Pollak's Chat Show, fanmail@gmail.com. Do you enjoy the earwolf experience or the new Howl? Tell us about that. We want to help them promote the Howl, which I believe we have nothing to do with, but I still love them so much. Corey, thanks for sitting in today.
No problem.
You've been with us on a few occasions. Do we know the number of shows you've actually done with us?
You got recognized recently from, we were at a party, a birthday party, and he's like, I've seen you on it was the Rainn Wilson Chat Show.
Yeah, where he assaulted me with a water bottle.
Rainn Wilson did?
Yes.
Well, he had reason.
Well, it's debatable, but I don't want to get into it.
Since I'm putting all the attention on you, you'd rather not go into detail about anything?
All right, I was Googling, and he thought I was texting, and he is. The scars run deep. That's all I have to say.
You were Googling something he asked, wasn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, I was researching something.
Let's call it fact-checking.
Sure.
Make your show sound a little better.
Okay.
That's exactly what it was.
Right.
I'm an all-facts kind of guy.
Anyone can Google, but only a certified fact-checker can.
Yeah.
Check facts.
Yeah.
Probably four or five, I would say.
Four or five
shows.
Now, we need also, J-Mac, to help confirm the number of shows this is. I have 247, but I feel like I've been writing 247 for a couple of weeks.
It says 246 on.
246. We got ahead of ourselves a few weeks.
You know what?
246.
Because there were two. Again, this really should happen off air. I noticed there were two 245s on iTunes or YouTube.
Yeah.
Like, there were double 245s.
Yes.
And one of them was 246. I'll be with you in just a minute. Hi, welcome back to the Chat Show. We took a little break to talk about some in-house stuff that you don't need to
We're
sit
back
through.
To
Hey, did you catch me on the Super High Roller Celebrity Shootout on the NBC Sports Network? Huh? I've been told that ratings were very well, and they're going to do them again. And as reigning champ of the celebrity side of things, I look forward to...
That was a fun weekend.
Another shot of that. It was a fun weekend, damn it. All too
well. That was a good group of celebs. It was you and Brad Garrett, Hank Azaria, Don Cheadle, and Norm MacDonald. And then we can't stop doing Norm MacDonald impressions now.
Yeah. Norm MacDonald. Also, can we talk a little bit about why he inexplicably replaced Daryl Hammond as the new spokesperson, allegedly the colonel in the KFC commercial?
I thought this was, from what I'm understanding, is this is a thing that they're going to do now, is they're rotating through like SNL cast members to be the...
I think that's a theory that we and our friends came up with as a way to wrap our brains around,
I guess, yeah,
the oddity that is...
I did see Mary Gross in that outfit.
And then that was the thing, and then I kept
that
trying
is deep
to come
track.
Up with, and then I kept trying to come up with like more obscure, like I was like, well, next it's going to be Colin Quinn.
Right.
Because that I was going like, we conducted it, like random weekend update people.
I think we just had the obscure off. I should probably introduce our guest since he's chiming in so much, and I forgot to tell him, as I often do, most often, that until I introduce you, you're off camera. You're being heard. So I should probably... Kyle Bornheimer, ladies and Jews, bring those paws together. He's here all hour. Be kind to your waitresses. Kyle, one of the things from the research dossier that I can't believe you and I haven't spoke about in our recent long hours together, I'll get into why that is in a moment, is that you recently worked with Warren Beatty, who, that's an interesting reaction to that.
Because you can't imagine how awesome it is that you've started with this question.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Because I have my own stories of Warren.
Oh. Those are the best. The best stories are Warren Beatty stories.
Well, So let's begin with, how did this come about? The movie's called...
Right now it's the untitled Warren Beatty Howard Hughes Project.
Sure.
And but he's been trying to do... So I'm a Warren Beatty, huge Warren Beatty fan.
Same here.
And think that he's really underrated. Like, legitimately, more than just being a fan, like, I think he's like a really underrated contributor to... the great movies of the 70s and that whole era of American filmmaking. But in general, like the history of American cinema, I think he's a huge part of it. He doesn't get enough credit for it, even though he was a huge star when
he won an Oscar for directing Reds.
Yeah,
But I agree, in the same way that a few other contributors, like even Redford, who is a director of a lot of great films, but also the Institute, not the Festival of Sundance, but the actual Institute and what it has done.
Oh, totally.
It's extraordinary. So the first call for the Warren Beatty untitled Howard Hughes Project comes from
me.
Sure.
I mean, I knew, because I'm I knew he'd been trying to make this movie for years. And I'd been joking recently when I found out that he was trying to do this Howard Hughes Project that he might not have known that Scorsese actually did a Howard Hughes movie. But
well, you're a big fan, and you also like to make fun of him.
Well, yeah, exactly. He and I have this whole thing,
sure,
where he'll come at me, and then I come at him, and
right.
But he was famous for seeing projects through, for having all these pet projects, and I mean, and you've just directed a movie. How hard it is to just do one movie, and for it to be a pet project, something that you wanted to do for a long time. And
wouldn't let go. It seems like 30 years he's been after the Howard Hughes story.
Yeah, and Bugsy was a movie he'd wanted to do before he did that, in whatever that 1990. He'd wanted to do that for 25 years. Dick Tracy he wanted to do since he was a kid.
Right.
Reds was on his mind for decades. Even Shampoo was like, he wanted to do like an American version of Rules of the Game. Like, he really had these pet projects that and by and large, he made them well. Like, it's easy to see these pet projects and lose the thread and then they don't quite work. But he made like a handful of pet projects, and they're great movies.
Yeah.
You know?
I remember in the early 70s was the first time he started to make efforts for, was it Bugsy or was it... It might have been Bugsy.
I'm sure he was trying to do it back then. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think they were just on his mind. I think he was actively
pursuing,
trying to raise money and trying to get it all that done. And besides, and he's a great actor in them too. I mean, he's underrated as an actor, I think, in his best work. You know,
yes.
He's got some flat work there too, but in about six or seven of his movies, he's it's stellar work too. He's not just a pretty face and someone that mounted a. And he's a smart guy. His movies are really smart. I mean, Reds is a really smart movie.
Extraordinarily.
Yeah. But I knew, and then when I, the second I heard he was doing it, I just was like, can I do anything? I just called my agents and managers and said, whatever can be done. They sent my reel, he watched my reel, which was awesome. And he had the cast director call me in to do this part.
What I find interesting, if I may interrupt, yeah. about your reel, because I also have seen it, it doesn't feature anything that you've done. It's just little pieces of movies that you love.
Exactly, and
that's
where
I twisted
it up. Yeah,
as an actor's
reel. Not even people that look like me to fool them to thinking I'm trying to pretend I'm Paul Rudd or something. No,
a lot of DiCaprio.
Yeah, yeah. It's just I went that route, and then they're so curious they bring me in,
mm-hmm.
and then I give them some money under the table, and I get into these.
Alfred
projects.
Molina, I think, is featured very well.
Another great underrated. He's probably rated correctly, but. Yeah, so I just bugged him to be in it and did the small part, and it was, you know.
Well, from your people inquiring and him watching your reel, then what happened?
Then the casting director is a fan of mine and was able to sort of say, this kid's really good. And so it's a tiny part. Who knows?
This kid, because Warren's in his 70s?
Because he's in his 70s, and I'm in... I celebrated him.
It's all over
birthday.
The internet. Just turned 40.
So, which is, by the way, when Beatty really was hitting his stride. We talked about this. How I feel like the early and mid 30s, and on, and for about 10 or 15 years, are a man's prime. Like when you can really hit your stride. And when I look back, Beatty actually is kind of a late bloomer. He was a huge star in the 60s, but he was kind of a pretty face, and his work isn't that great.
Right.
It's not until Bonnie and Clyde and McCabe and Mrs. Miller, when he's in his 30s or starting to get in his 30s, that he actually starts to hit his stride as an artist.
And I'm thinking Shampoo, he must have been...
At least 35, probably older, right? 38, 39?
Yeah.
I mean, maybe 40, so...
Do some quick math there for us, would you?
Yeah, I'm sure there's
Corey,
some
please.
Place we could look at.
I feel like Beatty must have been closer to 40 than 35 mm-hmm. when he did Shampoo.
I think you're right, and he was... So he was doing... That's when he started. Heaven Can Wait's great, and Reds. And
so the casting director is a fan of yours and gets word to him, and he watches the reel, and then...
And yeah, it's like me and... We were like three orderlies in this scene. This is really funny scene where... And I don't want to give anything away about the movie, but he's kind of put up in this hospital after one of his plane crashes. And apparently Howard Hughes designed a hospital bed that had pulleys and stuff for people that had an attraction. And he did this great comedy bit. Beatty does this great bit with this thing where we come in to help him and he's trying to get his bed to work and he's doing all this physical comedy. He did it like an amazing, and there's a couple other nerdy Beatty fans on set that I was rapping with about it, you know. And he does this, he talks about this, other actors will talk about the famous Beatty bow when he meets people and wants people to do their movies, and we all got a Beatty bow of like thanking us for being in this movie. He's gracious, his family was there, they were all sweet. Had a nice 70s film vibe where it took all week for him to shoot one scene but it was, you know, and he was like, oh, we'll come back tomorrow and do it, and let me figure, he did 50 takes on things, but everyone, you know, at least we loved it, and I'm sure there's plenty of crews that weren't into it as much.
Yeah.
But, and it seemed like the movie's going to come off well, so, because he's got a nice touch with things, but it was nice to do like a comedy scene with him, because that's the other thing about him, he actually has some pretty good comedy chops in the right thing.
Oh, you know, for sure. So how was his direction specifically?
It was very loose. He did a couple interesting things. I was watching off camera when he was working with one of the actresses, and he did this neat thing where he has them just count, look at the other actor for and count to 25, just so that he has a bunch of cutback material that he can use, you know. So much about filmmaking
count to 25
is,
to themselves.
So I would just look at you, and you be Beatty and tell me to count to 25.
Okay, so look at me and count to 25.
Oh, okay. And just look at you?
Yeah. And count to 25. Well, not me.
Yeah, so that's what the actor would do. It count to themselves to 25, and he would have all these reaction shots that he could cut back to and whatever he might need. You know, so
as
much
opposed
of, you know,
to be in the scene and we'll do your coverage listening to the other?
He would do both. But sometimes he would just want, you know, and it might, you know, it might be a specific situation he wants, like, oh, they're giving me too much, not enough. Let me just see what happens when they're neutral and, you know, I can project whatever I want.
Oh, they're not acting when they're counting to 25. Yeah, that's kind of brilliant. He wanted them not acting.
Yeah. And then there's a lot of takes and a lot of, like, don't cuts, do this now, and let me try that again. I'm going to go right away again. You know, he's just, he's got a nice light touch, but he also knows what he wants. He knows what's good. He knows what didn't just work. Let's do it again. You know, it's not a rigid thing. And he goes, does a lot of takes. But not in a weird Kubrickian kind of, I'm going to exhaust you. So, you know, it's just more like He's kind of a jazzy, you know, kind of, bloop, you know, let me try this way.
What was your audio interpretation of jazz again? Gotcha.
I'm not the Michael Winslow of sound effect comedy. No.
I smell a ringtone.
I love his work as an actor and director and always have. So when I did my first dramatic work in Barry Levinson's movie Avalon, Barry's next movie was Bugsy. So Warren Beatty was at the premiere of Avalon. And it was my first real dramatic work in a film, first work that really counted, right, as it were. I mean, I'd done, of course, The Wonderful Willow, which all the kids loved. But so Warren Beatty.
Hey, the grocery store clerk was very excited about
that. Recognize you from Willow?
The grocery
and
store
only
clerk.
Willow?
It's so weird to be recognized from a movie where you are.
What have you been doing since Willow?
Four inches tall.
Right.
And I'm wearing a rat head as a hat. I'm covered in fur and a lot of makeup tribunal
My
tattoos
part
all
of
over.
Said, yeah. He left you with. Hey, do you know where I can find that on Blu-ray?
Yeah. Yeah. That's how much of a fan he was.
You know, they've entrusted that information to me alone, and I can tell, yeah.
I really loved the. I showed my kids
he said, do you know where I could find it on Blu-ray? I really want to show it to my kids.
See, I didn't hear that part. What I heard him say was, I really loved you in Willow. You know where I can find it? And then you had to interpret to me, well, what he meant was, you know where I can find it?
Right.
Stack of them in the garage?
At where fine stores everywhere is the correct answer.
And then the longboards guy, they keep sending trucks onto the set at our stages Paramount. And longboards was the ice cream truck that was out the other day. And he said, I just showed my kids Willow.
Really?
I'm being haunted by this one.
Maybe it's in the air again. I mean,
it's in the ether.
Or they're doing that deep thing when you meet someone, but you want to bring up an obscure thing they've been in to show that you're a real fan.
There you go. Mickey 1 would be the one I would say to Warren Beatty.
Warren Beatty. Nice.
Yeah. So Warren comes up to me at the Avalon premiere, and I am shaking. That's how much of a historical, iconic movie star he is.
Yeah.
I had been around enough of them at that point. Steve Martin, I'd already done L.A. Story, and but shaking. And he said, really terrific work in the film. And I said, thank you, and I did that sort of embarrassing, groveling, humble, and he wasn't gonna let me off the hook with humility.
Yeah.
And reiterated, no, seriously, terrific. We'll see you again, sort of thing.
Yeah, it's so cool.
And I was just visibly shaking, and then I didn't see him again until the...
You auditioned for the Breathless role in Dick Tracy?
No, I did not audition for Breathless. Nice. He came to the premiere of A Few Good Men. And he came out, and I had my parents with me this time, and my family. Everyone came out for the big A Few Good Men, of course, just to see Jack Nicholson. But, so Warren came up to me again and
not
said...
Not Kevin Bacon,
no. Okay. They skipped the Bacon. Hold the bacon.
He only does one Kevin per appearance will he go up to.
Yeah. But he came up to me and he said, you did it again? As a way to say, remember when I said the thing to you before.
You know, he has a famous memory. And he has a famous... someone told me this story about him, a girl coming up to him, an interviewer, and him not remembering her name or playing that he didn't remember her name or something. And she's like, oh, don't you remember I interviewed you for this or this back in, you know, this was like 1994. And she's like, back in 84, I interviewed you. And he's like, oh, yeah, I don't know. And then she's like, oh, you should have remembered me. And he goes, and he turned and he goes, wait, 213-446-99. He remembered the phone number. And
holy,
I've heard this two times where another person he's gone up to them and remember, he's got like a famous,
he also, like the Bill Clinton, has a way when he talks to you and looks into your eyes to make you feel like you're the only human being on the planet.
Yeah.
And having had that moment now with both of them, those are the two people that I'd always heard that about.
Yeah.
And I absolutely 100% felt that way. So then, shortly thereafter, the great Les Moonves, our current boss, is running Warner Brothers at the time. And after Suspects, I got this development situation to do a TV show.
Right.
So I got offices and a secretary and the production company's all set up there. And my agent calls, says Warren Beatty wants you to be in, he's remaking, oh gosh, the hell was the name of the original? I can't remember, but Corey, look up Warren's directing biography, and Annette Bening was in it.
Oh yeah, Love Affair.
Love Affair.
He was redoing.
He redid
Affair to Remember.
Affair to Remember.
Yeah.
So, did you see his remake?
You know, I got it. That's my blind spot on Warren. I never did see Love Affair.
Yeah. So, my agent says he wants you to be in the film. He and Glenn Gordon Caron. Yeah, the guy who did Moonlighting, who's writing the remake. I want to take you to lunch. I said, have him take me to lunch at the commissary at Warner Brothers, where I have an office now, Les Moonves could walk by the table and see me sitting with Warren Beatty. And it worked. I choreographed it, and it worked perfectly. Yeah, it worked perfectly. And he said, you know, I want you to play my friend in the movie, and, you know, we'll have a handful of scenes where, you know, it'll be fun. And so I thought we'd have go to lunch and get to know each other a little. So it's an out-of-body experience in every way. I'm hanging on every word he says. And then my agent calls because they've started to make the deal. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was in a bit of a catbird seat after A Few Good Men and Suspects. And mm-hmm. there were, as a character actor, there was a living to be made.
Right, right.
And the money was like a quarter of what the so-called quote was at that point. And I said to my agent, I don't care. I really don't care. It doesn't matter. He said, okay, fine. Then he comes back and he says, he needs to tie you up for 9 months. Because that's just how
that old school filmmaker.
Yeah. And I said, what do you mean, tie me up? I'll be free to go away and do other things, though, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, he's in first position. No, the way he works or whatever. However it was explained to me, it became instantly clear I was not going to be able to do this movie because I couldn't take 9 months off to do anything.
Yeah.
And it remains 100% one of the all-time great apex of the list of regrets.
But I don't regret,
I know why the decision was made the way it was made, and I talked to him afterwards. And he certainly understood, but
you regret that the chance to have that experience.
Yeah,
not that you made a bad career choice or something. Just more like
devastating. Like, yeah, and then when I saw in that research that you had worked with him, I went to the IMDb page of the movie and I saw that Oliver Platt, because there's a group of us character actors who kind of fit in the
same.
We all have those groups, and Ollie Platt and Tony Shalhoub and Stanley Tucci. You know, through the '90s, I remember Stanley Tucci came up to my ex-wife and said, is your husband going to get all the work? Now, of course, the joke is that Stanley Tucci gets all the work.
Right, right.
So I saw that Oliver Platt was in the film, and I thought, see? Mm-hmm. There was a chance I could have worked with Warren. He said, nope, he had his chance, fuck him.
Right.
Because that's the only thing that goes through your mind.
Of course, you're like, it's my last time I'll ever have that opportunity to work.
Yeah, but he's always been instantly charming and wonderful every time I've seen him since. Which included just walking by a beach in Hawaii at one point, where I was staying at a hotel, and he and the family had a house that was attached to the hotel or something, and just spent like 30 minutes standing on the beach talking about Al Gore.
Well, it's a great thing too. You say that, like, and not to make this the Warren Beatty show, but why not? I don't know him. I met him that week, and he was gracious that I wouldn't. You know, he might not even remember I was in the movie, but although his great memory would tell him.
He'd have your phone number.
Yes, he'd have my phone number set. But in terms of like conducting yourself within any industry or within your career, treating people with respect, you know, I don't know if he's what he is as a person, but in terms of like cultivating
as a professional,
and you look at the people he worked with time and time again, and other stories about how he treated people within the industry, just straight up respect and dignity. Obviously. You know, I think about that often. I always think about we've talked about Mad Men a lot, like how John Hamm plays that character.
Yeah.
And it's easy to like go on the first viewing, oh, it's just these like misogynist dudes, you know. But if you watch his performance in that, like, and he says it in the first episode, I think, of the whole series, when Pete's acting like a jerk to people, and Hamm stops him and say, just so you know, if you treat people like shit, you're not going to make it along in here. And it's not like Ham goes overboard to be, I'm from the Midwest and I get really insecure that I'm being too polite and too,
sure.
you know. And I'll watch, what's his name, Vic Mackey on The Shield used to do this too. People that just sort of make the right decision to treat a person like, you're a human being, I'm gonna treat you through respect, I'm not gonna go overboard, I'm not gonna
right.
talk down to you, it's just what do you need in this circumstance? Are you treating me with respect? Am I treating you with respect? And we'll be gracious to each other.
Yeah.
And I'm just, as I grow older and watch how I conduct my inner relationships, I'm always sensitive to that. Like, just treat people respectfully. And
it's the only thing that came out of organized religion for me that made sense was do unto others.
Sure, of course.
There's no way to live your life honestly in any other. There's no other way to do it.
No, yeah, it is. It's a great.
Because how can you ever ask that of others unless you're putting it out there?
Exactly.
It always blows my mind when someone isn't that. Let's congratulate our co-star. One of the threats I made. We may never get to the Bulgaria story. Jane Lynch won an Emmy yesterday.
So great.
She won an Emmy in the most ridiculous way. Now, I just came from the last show where Allison Janney wins anything just for showing up. In fact, she won yeah. two Emmys last year, one for Best Supporting.
Best Shower-Upper.
Best Shower-Upper. Yeah. For Masters of Sex, Best Supporting, yeah. and then she won for Mom. And I'm feeling like I'm going to go way out on a limb. In fact, jinx everything and say Jane Lynch
yeah.
will be nominated next year for the program that you and I are doing, and she will beat Allison Janney.
Yeah.
Is that crazy?
No, I'm going with you on that.
Yeah.
I'm supporting.
But I feel like these are the two actresses. There's a few of them where
yeah.
they get hired, and then the Emmy organization lines up and says, well, these are the ones we're nominating.
Mm-hmm.
So congratulations to Jane Lynch for winning an expected Emmy, I think is what we're going to have to call it at this point.
Yeah, winning another Emmy.
Host for reality or reality competition program. She won for best
and the
host.
One she'll,
game
she'll
night.
Win for our show will be best actress. Best
That'll be lead. A year from now.
Yeah, this September, next time this year, or next year this time, we'll be having this conversation. And
you'll come back?
Ourselves. I'll come back if you'll have me. For Warren Beatty Part 2.
Let's jump ahead to a question that comes up a lot on. Well, first of all, I will follow a little tradition. Mishawaka.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes. Good job.
Mishawaka.
The Princess City.
Princess City of Indiana. Mishawaka. Why is it the Princess City?
I believe Mishawaka
was a princess.
Was a princess. Yeah.
Uh huh. You were born there.
Born in Mishawaka.
Schooled
in Mishawaka near South Bend, Indiana. So it's a sister city to South Bend, Indiana, which is where Notre Dame is, which most people associate with.
Yeah. How small is
Mishawaka? When I was growing, I mean, it was 50,000, and then South Bend's maybe 150 or 200.
And how far away is South Bend?
Next door.
Is it just up the road?
Santa Monica and Beverly Hills. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
So you feel like you're connected to a major metropolitan city in South Bend.
No, but you can feel like you're part of Chicago because Chicago is not far from. So we would get a lot of Chicago. We get WGN from Chicago. We would watch the Bulls and the Cubs. There's a lot of crossover between Chicago and other parts of northern Indiana. Yeah.
So what were the sports?
I mean, well, I grew up a Notre Dame fan because South Bend with Notre Dame. And then I have
baseball.
Baseball was the Brewers because my dad's from Milwaukee, and I was a Packer fan. But I was also kind of a Cubs fan, kind of a Bears fan. Even though as a kid I didn't know Bears and Packers were rivals, so and it was Peyton and
you're not a smart kid.
And I was not a wise child. So I liked, and it was the '80s, and the Bears were awesome. So,
but then you had Peyton,
and the Bulls were great because of Jordan. So it was easy to be. And I was a big Siskel and Ebert fan because that came out of Chicago as well.
Sure.
And for some reason, WGN did Sunday movies all the time, too. And it'd be these, like, long classic dramas. Moby Dick always played. I remember watching Moby Dick all the time.
What was your obsession with Moby Dick, do you think?
Should we get into that?
Sure.
I just read Moby Dick, actually, the book. I just read it for the first time.
Well, you buried the lead.
Yeah.
That you read. Yeah. I've never read the book Moby Dick.
Yeah.
What was the experience like?
It's huge.
Sure.
And it is equal parts. This is what I didn't know, which is kind
whale.
Of interesting. It's a whaling encyclopedia, actually. It works. There'll be chapters that are just about types of whales, types of whale mouths. Like, it literally is just a guide for whaling. It was probably released as a serialized thing, whatever. But then, and then there's be a chapter that's really legitimately exciting. Like you see a movie in your head while you're, so it's like boring, boring stuff about whales unless you love whales. And then like a really still very exciting to this day, Jaws type of, you know, capturing him and, you know, with this great character who's obsessed with it and how he puts his crew in danger for it. And, you know, it was a slog at times, but you know, when you're this age and you decide you're gonna read again, you're like, I gotta get through this. I gotta prove to myself I can still read.
Even when you were bored to tears.
Yeah, you know, yeah. I did a lot of audiobooking too that I could skip through some chapters. So, yeah. So they should have audiobooks where you can do like crib notes at the same time, so you can skip certain chapters.
I want to get to the point where I can listen to one audiobook and read another.
I've been doing that. Oh, you mean at the same time?
Same time.
I'm sure there are people that can do that.
That's an ADD issue, for sure.
Or some sort of meditation. You can get one part of your mind working.
I can't even stay present for the book I'm reading. I need to listen to another book.
And then watch, you know, like season three of The Wire as a third thing. Because that's the thing now when I read a book, I'm like, I could be watching a really great cable drama.
Wow.
Yeah, getting caught up on The Affair or something, yeah.
And when was the moment in Mishawaka that you first had an inkling towards anything to do with show business?
I started loving movies early, but I don't. It was movies. It was just movie love that made me attracted to anything entertainment based. We had a big movie collection at my house. My dad was a big movie fan, not like a movie buff. He just had, you know, he loved taping. He loved putting a VHS in and taping, putting hit and play and record, and taping whatever movie was on.
What he was doing was stealing.
He was stealing. My dad was stealing. And I told him, I said, Dad, they're going to take us away. It says right there, the FBI.
I remember doing this as well, and it never dawned on me that that was the first version of pirating.
Pirating, yeah.
Because everyone was doing it, but it wasn't, everyone was doing it knowing they were doing something wrong. No one had a notion that there was anything wrong about it.
Well, I don't think it got weird until the means of distributing that and actually having an effect on so-and-so's rights for residuals. I mean, my dad's, the breadth of his distribution network was the living room with the five kids and maybe a couple friends I would have come over to watch. So,
he would say, I recorded Patton, and now we're going to
Patton
watch it.
Patton is a great example. Patton was on there, and it was over. I remember Patton part one, and then it didn't. And then he got to the end of the VHS, so I had to pull out. He had a whole booklet
if
that
was
numbered.
If it was more than 2 hours.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, you remember when you would buy the movies? You'd buy The Godfather on VHS, and it'd be two huge VHS tapes.
Technically, all the VHS tapes were the same size.
Yeah, yeah. So they weren't. Yeah, it wasn't a bigger one. It wasn't like you had a huge. You know, you had to get it as a 3/4.
Right.
Yeah. It's an epic movie. Yeah. Gone with the Wind comes as a. So he had a big movie collection. There was just a lot of talk about, I always knew actors' names because he'd be watching movies. Oh, that's Lee Marvin. You know, so I just always logged that. And then when I got into high school, my friends turned me on to some of the more edgy stuff. And then I was in high school during the 90s when the independent film movement was really hitting, like Usual Suspects and all the Tarantino
stuff. Quentin Tarantino
becomes
a bit of a beacon for you, ultimately. Leading to the move, Go West, Young Man, at the age of 19.
Totally, 19.
And but the idea wasn't acting. It was, I'm going to go out there and be a filmmaker?
Yeah, I'm just going to work in a video store, write a script, someone will discover me, and I'll make a movie. Isn't that how this works?
But literally.
Yeah.
It's funny what you're saying, but you're not kidding.
No, that was the plan. I mean, I knew I needed to, like, get good at it. And
learn
work hard
something.
And learn something, and... I wasn't too deluded. And as a matter of fact, I was very serious when I was nervous that because I didn't go to film school, that I had to like really bear down and, you know, write my scripts and get them out there. And, you know, and I.
Have you gone back and read any of those early scripts?
Oof, that would be a fun experiment. I made a couple short little films that no one saw, but that were fun and fun.
That
to
you
do
wrote and directed?
That I wrote and directed. Tried to, you know, I had buddies that we would try to put stuff up, and I just could never get it. There was no internet. It wasn't there yet, and I wasn't quite good at it enough. I did probably need to go to film school and learn how to be a better writer, you know. And
so when you directed the short, what did you base your knowledge of how to do it on?
The one short that I actually shot on 16mm, it came off pretty well. I mean, studied a lot of
had not
on my
been
own.
On a set of a movie
had not been on a set I'd been I'd done some PA work I'd been on a little bit of set and I was pretty driven to do it right. It didn't come off horribly. I had some instincts and I was well schooled enough on my own, you know, and I did do, I did UCLA Extension, I made up my own little film school in certain ways by trying to school myself the best I could.
Sure.
But I was spinning my wheels for a lot in my first few years in LA. I just couldn't figure out how to build a career.
I'm not sure how any was, and I even had a, you know, every reason to jump right into the fray coming from stand-up comedy in San Francisco and a door opening at the Improv to come in and do sets right away. So I had the ability to jump into the setting, and I still took years to figure out how does this fucking thing work?
As a writer, director, producer, or as actor?
Someone who wanted to get into acting.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I refused to join an acting class because mm-hmm. I had no discipline, and I also hated school growing up so much.
Right.
That the idea that I was going to be able to do this because I took a class just flew in the face of logic and why I wanted to do it.
Yeah.
And also I thought, well, if someone's teaching acting, they're not acting, and is that the person I want to learn acting from?
Yeah.
Which is also very stupid.
It's silly, yeah.
And a lie you tell yourself.
Yeah, you do a lot of, I did a lot of rationalizing with both film and directing, writing, and acting about, I don't want to do that because of this. When I look back, I say, you know what, I probably should have just done that.
Finally, at 24, you enroll in an acting class taught by Ivana Chubbuck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that Chubbuck.
Was and I went as a director. In my mind, I was like, I got free classes out of it. I said, I just want to watch how actors work so I can learn how to talk. And it was probably genuine. It was silly.
With that tone, though.
Yeah. Well, that was yes. That's how obnoxious I was at 24. I was trying to talk like Peter Bogdanovich. I would wear the ascot. But instantly I started probably seeing. It's funny you say, as an actor, you were trying to figure out how even with some of the open doors that you were trying to figure out how to start a career. And acting is actually where I saw what I could do, which was I couldn't find that with writing and directing. For my own fault of like some of the similar stuff, like, oh, I'm not going to go to film school because of this. I was probably just afraid of the competition at film school.
Sure.
Or afraid of not to
Or
just
finding
be,
out you were no good.
Finding out I was good or finding out I was just one of, you know, a bunch of people from the Midwest that want to make movies. You know,
yeah.
I was probably, if I stay in my apartment and do my thing, get to, you know, make myself discovered, whatever, it's all bullshit. But as an actor, I was like, oh, there's a tract. What I'll do is take these acting classes, say yes to every short film or small play that someone wants me to be part of. I don't care if I'm good or bad, I'm just gonna keep my nose down and get good at it, or just learn the process, and try to get a commercial agent.
Did you have any naysayers early on? I had a pretty horrendous first.
Who?
First person I read for.
Like a casting director?
She was potentially going to be a manager. I was at the Improv, and somebody said, well, you want to get into acting, you need an agent or a manager. No way to get either. And then someone
were
said,
were you up north still?
There's this,
Up north still, or were you down
No,
here?
This was in yeah. L.A.
Yeah.
So she said, come to my office and read a scene for me. And so I'd never seen sides or pages from a scene.
Yeah.
That's how out of... So I went near the room and I did what I could to memorize it. And I came back in and I did the scene for her, and she said, well, listen, acting's not for everyone. And not kidding.
Yeah.
That was her. Now, by the way, she could have been, she was in the business of making money off of talent.
Yeah, right.
And so all I heard was her saying, well, you've got no talent.
Yeah.
There's no way for me to make any money off you. But she said, but maybe stand-up is really what you're supposed to be doing, and I know you come from that world, so just focus on that. And it was one of those classic, you walk out of there, I'll show her.
Right. Oh, I was curious how you internalized it.
That's how I reacted. I'll show her.
Oh, good.
That's and then did nothing about it.
Right.
Then join the acting
because
class.
There's another classic thing, which is I fucking suck, and I, you know, I messed that up so bad. I mean, I used to get...
I always blamed
so
others.
So hard. Oh, you blame others.
I always blamed others.
I have more self-loathing than you, apparently.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would always... Yeah, you get pretty... It's interesting. And I had a willful... I remember my car got stolen the week I moved to L.A.
Day three, according to the research.
Oh, really?
You were in L.A. three days.
Yeah, my Toyota Tercel that I'd driven out with my sister. Was living out here. She flew out, and we drove back together, back out to L.A. together. And right underneath where I was staying at the time, at a friend's place, my car was stolen. And I remember saying to myself, all right, big city one, Kyle zero.
But the research also showed that you were in an interview said you were kind of happy because you weren't sure you were going to be able to make the payments.
Could have never made the payments. So it was, and then I worked.
That was a great sidebar.
Right down here at Tower, we're in Santa Monica right now near the Third Street Promenade, and I walked out the door the next day without a car, knowing I had to find a job nearby. And for the next few years, worked at Tower Records, which is no longer in existence.
Right
down the road here. I lived up here on 4th in California. And worked at Tower Records, so and walked and bussed for, which is people somehow find that to be the most shocking thing. Like you didn't have a car for the first 5 years I was here. I just walked and bussed.
5 years.
Yeah, probably about 5 years before I got a car, I'd say. Yeah, I bought a car with a friend.
You may want to talk to the people at the Guinness Book.
being in LA is that long without a.
Yeah.
Maybe. I mean, with Uber and hopefully a subway system here in the next, what, I think they're on track for
the next 20 years,
yeah.
I think.
You know, we might be able to
So you literally busted and rode a bike or whatever?
Yeah, I mean, the tower was real close, and then I...
Yeah, but there's a whole other city here.
Which, by the way, I didn't...
Never saw.
I never saw Los Feliz or you know, anything east of...
You get invited to a party.
Yeah, I was like, whoa.
East of the 405.
Yeah. I have a friend that I volunteer with, and he lives on the east side, and he works at Disneyland, and he doesn't have a car. And I'm like, what? He takes public transportation to Disney to
you
Anaheim.
You can take Anaheim pretty easily, actually.
And yeah. I was like, what do you do? And he's like, I read. He just but he spends like 3 hours a day, can be like on going to or from work. He just reads a lot.
I did the bus, and I would go up Wilshire.
But it blows my mind. I'm like, what do you mean?
But the reading thing's important, and now with podcasts and everything, I would have gotten so much.
Right.
I would actually look forward, and I would sleep a lot on the bus, too.
Yeah, go he does Wilshire. That, too.
Yeah, he
sleeps.
End up falling
he sleeps and reads. Sleeps and reads. But it blows my mind that I was like, you want to work at Disneyland that badly that you won't? But he's like, yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry. Kenny, how are we doing on the 45-minute mark? You were asking them?
Yeah, no. You can go right now.
We can go right now to the mid-roll? Kyle, would you mind if we take a moment for the sponsor? Mm-hmm. Would you just shut up for 2 seconds?
So sorry.
Jesus. All right. Well, today is also another very important day for a lot of people out there. It is the first Sunday of the NFL season.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of dreams being broken today. Shattered week one. There was a Thursday night game. J-Mac. The Steelers came up against Tom Brady, trying to prove his value to the world at large. And but you guys made a showing of it. 28-21, was that the final?
Yeah.
So if you're listening to this after the fact, you're not one of the 4,700. Let's remove the word 100. Watching this live. thank you both. The first week of the NFL season is in the books. My question to you is, how did your fantasy team do? Did you win any money? No? Well, you can on FanDuel this next weekend. Go to FanDuel now. FanDuel is the trusted leader in one-week fantasy football with more winners and more payouts than any other site. Now, that's a claim that they've backed up with this statistic. FanDuel is paying out, brace yourselves, over $75 million a week this football season. Now, what the hell? $75 million a week? Building your team is easy. Just pick your players, stay under the salary cap, and sit back on Sunday and watch your team win. Entry fees start at just $1. So you go from $1 to being a part of $75 million in payout. Anyone can play. Over 1 million users have already won some sweet cashish playing fantasy football on FanDuel. Dear Lord, what the hell are you waiting for? Go to FanDuel.com, click the microphone in the upper right-hand corner, and use the chat show promo code, which is just the word chat, C-H-A-T, chat, and sign up now. Our very own Mike Duman, it took me, I think, 19 episodes of the chat show to learn how to correctly pronounce his name.
So difficult.
Plays on the fantasy football and has given his life to it. Duman, a very hard name to learn, yeah.
Duman.
And he's playing right now, as a matter of fact. He's holding up his phone, I promise you. Special offer for our new users. Go, for example, for every dollar that you deposit, FanDuel match it up to $200. That gets earned as you play. That's a sweet bonus of up to $200. This offer is only good to the first 50 of you out there who use the code CHAT and sign up today. So support this show, you son of a bitch, and have a goddamn good time and win some money, honey. That's promo code CHAT. First 50 to sign up, you get the dollar for dollar match up to $200. FanDuel.com, where every day is a new season. That's FanDuel.com. Sign up today. I want to thank them for being a sponsor of this particular program. You folks out there, you say you want to support the show. All right, so then we'll go to the percentage of you that want to support the show and play fantasy football. Stop fucking around. Go to FanDuel and use the promo code CHAT. Other business here. We like to have tweet fives for the guest. I did not yell at the folks on Twitter to serve up a tweet five. Natalie Rosen back on the show after the Burning Man. I don't know if anything came through the Facebook page. I'm going to assume no, since I got nothing. I don't want to assume that Natalie actually dropped the ball, because she's, you know, went from the greatest unpaid intern in the history of Chat Show
to paid assistant
to executive assistant of yours truly as a filmmaker and television actor. So we're just going to go with no tweet fives for the guest. And I'm going to rub it in his face.
She can come on and talk about Burning Man.
I'm going to rub it in his face even further.
I think that's fascinating.
Yeah. I am not as curious about Burning Man as you would think.
Cannot think of anything I would rather do less.
I'm trying not to place any sort of judgment on the world's greatest executive assistant for going to Burning Man. Trying to be open and appreciative of a 22-year-old's life, and that she should do things that are
seemingly
ridiculous.
I asked her what it was like,
ridiculous.
And she summed it up by saying, it's like Tatooine.
Like Tatooine?
Tatooine.
Oh, Tatooine, the planet from...
the planet. What she said?
Where no one showers and lives in dirt?
Yeah.
Is that what happens on Tatooine?
Hey, you know that thing you see in commercials that where people are there's like a powder thrown on everyone and it's different colors? And have you seen this thing? And it's like, I guess based on your reaction, this doesn't happen as much as I thought. I was wondering if this was like legitimately a thing that happens at for kids these days.
Did they throw powder in your face?
Yeah, it's like there's like a festival in India where they do this, right? Or somewhere where, right? Now, does this happen in real life in America at festivals anymore? Because based on like, you know, iPhone ads and things, this looks like something
they have
that's...
those rods, like color rods, where they shoot
with they shoot everyone with that? Okay.
So there was no dust in the face of Burning Man?
You have to roll around in it.
You have to roll around in it. And did they still actually burn a man? That's always been my favorite thing about Burning Man. I thought it was just a big structure that they make out of wood. No.
They pick one person, and it's like,
there's a lucky fan.
Yeah, they're having a great time, and they stop everything, and they pick a guy, and that guy's not happy.
It's usually a guy named Larry, according to the research. We're going to further rub the no teat five for the guest. Because there's one for me and there's one for Jamie that was written by a fan. If I can find the one, I may have discarded it already. Let's see how I do. So you read
my sides, by the way.
You read the T5, one that was for success for Kevin. If you can, because I shouldn't read my own. I should just give the answer. Mm. Can you do
that? Well, there's three here.
Yeah. So there's... Right. The T5, well, there's Jamie's. So it says T5, then it says my name.
Yeah.
And then just read the this or that questions, if you would, you son of a bitch. No?
This is fun. Aaron Sorkin or Christopher McQuarrie?
Yeah, don't read them to yourself. Read them out loud.
That wasn't vocalized? But for years,
Aaron
I've been
Sorkin
saying
or Christopher
that
McQuarrie?
Way.
Christopher McQuarrie. What's the next one?
Red State or Cop Out?
Red State.
Larry Miller as Angry Doorman or Larry Miller as Dean?
Larry Miller as Dean.
Yeah, Angry Doorman's a Seinfeld reference, so you wouldn't have got that.
Right.
Because you never saw that show, Seinfeld?
Sinfeld.
Steinfeld,
as my mom Steinfeld. Still calls it.
Steinfeld.
Rob Reiner insists his name should have been Steinfeld, and there was a T removed. Rob Reiner insisted up and down that Seinfeld is not actually a name. Next one, please.
Well, yeah, so what's this mean? Oh, this is from the person?
Yeah, that's Richmond is left over from Dean.
Oh, okay.
The next one would be?
Hated Juggernaut or beloved cult film?
Hated Juggernaut.
I guess this means...
Would you rather be a hated Juggernaut or be in a beloved cult film?
Is that what you're saying? Yeah, or, that's a great interpretation. That's
or do you like hating Juggernauts or loving cult films?
That's a horrible...
Is that the worst interpretation?
Interpretation, yeah. Would I rather be in a hated Juggernaut or be in a cult film for sure? For sure. 100%.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Street clothes or full dress uniform?
Oh, the whites? Nobody likes the whites? Is that a Few Good Men
Probably
reference?
A Few Good Men, yeah.
Street clothes is my answer. And then, is that it?
And then what's this? Do I do this one?
Oh, that's Sam. We'll wait for Sam to return before we read Sam's. Jamie, I have a tweet fire for you. David Putty or Tim Watley?
Putty.
Caddyshack or Groundhog Day?
Groundhog Day.
Ariel's Undersea Adventure or Soaring Over California? Gotcha!
Finally,
Sophie's choice.
I love Soarin' because of like the technology, but I do love that Ariel's Undersea Adventure is like a traditional Disney dark ride. But I do think that Ariel is an overrated Disney princess. She's the most beloved. Well, before Anna and Elsa, she's the most beloved Disney princess, and I think she's way overrated. So I'm gonna go Soarin'.
As a comment. As a protest that she's overrated.
I think, I think that everything, there's too much Little Mermaid stuff and not enough. Like, where's my Robin Hood, people?
People.
Right. Where's my Robin Hood?
This next one's gonna be a very quick answer. John Hamm or Chris Pratt?
Oh, John Hamm.
Jew jokes or no new jokes? I think that's a comment on me.
Jew jokes or no new jokes? I love a good Jew joke.
Yeah, and I think you've said far too many times on the show that I had
no new jokes.
Yeah.
And then the last one is Nintendo Entertainment System or Sega Genesis Battlestar?
Oh, and original NES for sure.
Original NES is the correct answer. All right.
Mine were easy.
Thank you for writing in the tweet five. Did we have, is this a Larry King? I'm just going to do the tweet five and get back to our guests. Okay, so we're on a show together. A question that comes up a lot here on this chat show for guests is one that I offer to you now, which is, what's your favorite thing about working with me?
Just one?
Things.
Thank you for opening the... I like your Hollywood stories.
Sure.
I like the Hollywood stories.
That's the best thing about working with me is that I have good stories. It's not that we have fun in a scene together. It's not
things.
That I'm an inspiring presence.
First of all, I said things and I didn't say what order they're going to be.
It's that I have good stories.
Yeah. I like the Hollywood stories.
I love your honesty.
Well, I like to also go to the personal first. Before that, you know, work.
Yeah.
You know, work's work.
Come on.
Work's work. Who wants to talk about that? It's the off-camera stuff where magic also happens. I like that we do make each other laugh, we've discovered, during scenes.
In the scene.
And I immediately called publicity and said, we got some good bloopers for you guys. Because I'm also, I just tweeted this recently, like, I get as much joy out of bloopers now as I did when I was 10.
You know, there was a moment when it became passé. I think Burt Reynolds put it in the end credits of too many of his
films.
Right,
and they were kind of contrived, yeah.
But I love it.
Yeah, and I love it even today. Like, I like when they bleep.
Yes.
For some reason, the bleep is the most underrated comedic tool.
Yes.
Bleep
it.
And it can be lame. They could be not even, there's actually, I don't know if you can YouTube it, but a long time ago, really old footage of bloopers, like Betty Davis or Olivia de Havilland, like Jimmy Stewart saying fuck, you know, like, in black and white in this pristine silver screeny thing, but then breaking and doing bloopers.
Oh my God.
It was really fun. It was really fun to find. And I haven't actually done it in the YouTube era. Somebody had a VHS of it. Remember when you would pass VHS around of all this crazy stuff?
Sure.
Like the farting preacher and like before YouTube, there'd be that kind of stuff. But But yes, I like that we discovered that we can get the laughs.
Can't get through a scene.
We can't get through a scene together, which I've
loved. I ended up having to look at your forehead.
We had some things like, when we do this take, let's not look at each other.
Yes.
We had these completely unprofessional things like,
you were doing
like, can you just do an insert of my hand while we're doing this, and you'll hear, we'll ADR it later because we can't, yeah.
You were doing a pronunciation of one word so ridiculously making me laugh every time that I just said, on my coverage, don't do it that well. When the camera's over you, onto me. I'm not looking for inspiration. I need you to not do it the way you were doing it so I can get through it.
And I would just look at your left cheekbone rather than your eyes to get through a scene.
I still have a cheekbone. That's exciting.
But yeah, it's those are two things. One more?
Yeah, no, it's mostly meant as a joke, but thank you for answering it as sincerely as possible. You've done a number of television series, but you have a track record now of one and done. You call yourself, before others get a chance, a show killer.
Right.
You're on, but what's written about you in the research over and over again is that everyone's saying this is the one as a way to promote the new one. Whatever the new one is, we know you've been. So I'm gonna follow in that suit, and let you know that I think I've got a theory.
Hey, let's hear it.
Yeah, it's based on a few quotes that are attributed to you. These are your own words.
Great.
You were being asked why a certain new show you were on was doing so well. That's the thing about the show killer.
I was asked this question. I don't even know what show I would have been asked about.
But that's the thing about the show killer. Some of these shows start off well.
Right. Oh, and then you go and kill it. You want to tease and then kill. You want to make the victim feel like, you know, you want to dance around before you cut off the cop's ear.
This happens. That's why I can't even celebrate if our show does well, if it does well. Like, I remember Robin's last show, Crazy Ones. Its first season was huge.
Yeah.
And then they moved it to another night and it fell off the face of the earth. Yeah. It was gone by the halfway through the second season. So there's no way
there's a myriad of reasons
ever relax your sphincter. So you said, I quote, one question you always ask about when you do a show is, what is this going to be week in, week out? And the showrunners had great answers for me. And it got me really excited. Not even just for one season, but we had plenty of ideas on what we could do. So my theory is, when asked about the new show, don't talk about how well things are going to go.
Great.
Yeah, don't stop doing that.
Should I just do like a politician, like answer another question completely? Answer the question I wanted to be asked?
Yes,
yeah.
Yes. Get it back on point.
NAFTA, I'll just say,
yeah. Say the bloopers look great.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, here's another gem. We have a nice, when talking about your co-stars, we have a nice collaboration. We are all committed to making it something really special. The scripts come in incredibly polished, and we are working with some of the best writers in the business. Are you aware of what it sounds like when you use a term, some of the best writers in the business?
No. What does it sound like?
Some of the best writers in the business.
I should say the best writers?
No.
I should say leave out the some? They're at the bottom of the best?
So this is that's actually the section that's what it's like working with these particular writers.
Yeah. this should be another podcast, which is
things not to say in interviews.
Interviews, yeah, like an interview review show, like where you review interviews.
Interviews,
it's
right?
Kind of brilliant.
This is why I'm trying to help you.
Yeah.
And lastly, in dealing with your cast, it is great working with such a great cast. You go to work and everyone is just cracking up. Everyone just wants to do extraordinary work, and it is just inspiring. Everyone is really feeding off each other. Uh-huh. The material was so good. Sure. We were just playing off each other so well that it was like being on a constant comedy high. Here's the best part. I literally have 7 seasons of ideas for the show. Oh. Show killer. You can't say these things. You don't want to know what a jinx means?
Well, you know what's funny about that?
Everything.
It's funny, as you read it, like I can not only imagine myself saying it, but every actor at a press junket. So whenever I watch like your show, or even going back, I haven't watched Actors Studio in a long time, or you read like a magazine that is a trade magazine right. rather than a People magazine, right? And you can
actual interviews.
Actually get in, like it's what I love about this and a couple other shows like this. Some of the best writers, some of the best podcast interviewers.
Right.
My brother and I watch talk a lot about Dick Cavett and like the long format.
Sure.
Or he would just sit down for an hour.
John Lennon,
and 50 minutes. Yeah, and they'd be like, you know, we'll come back tomorrow. We'll finish this up, Mr. Brando. You know, like just and there's nothing to plug, or if there is, it's a soft plug, whatever. And I would do this when I read, you know, like a magazine when it's like talking to other people. You know, you can be real when you go to these press junkets and you have to be locked and loaded with sound bites.
Yeah.
And it's fine. It's part of the deal, you know. But you can't. You're not going to talk. Inside baseball, and you're not gonna right. The real reason for single season shows are there is no reason at
no.
all, because it's
winning
all
the
regime
lottery.
Change. Oh, this one might have sucked. This one was really good, but there was
no your
I
lead
got
in.
Booted.
Lead in is everything. Yeah. There are 8 million reasons to die. In fact, when a show survives, I just think you've won the lottery because you have same odds of getting on a show, doing it, getting it, casting a pilot, the pilot getting picked up. When 80% of them don't.
Yeah.
That show getting any kind of time slot, because when you come in as a new show, you're clearly taking over a time slot that was vacated by the last show that failed.
Yeah.
There's no new great
time
slot.
It's like a restaurant going
slot.
In and like, oh, that restaurants never work on that corner. Yeah.
You'll do fine.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. There's.
And it's a different landscape now. I mean, it's.
You get a couple million viewers, you're a hit.
Yeah.
It is kind of crazy. All right. The question that keeps coming up, you've been on a few shows, as we mentioned. So we asked our Twitter and Facebook audience to weigh in on some potential explanations. Because you and I just tried to find some explanations.
Right, right.
So we thought we'd ask total strangers, not people who care about you
sure.
or me or us. But I want you to tell me if any of these do make sense.
Okay.
It's harder to find an audience these days than ever before. I think we just touched on that.
Maybe. No. I mean, you could argue the opposite, right? We're
well,
such a fragmented society that, like, you people find audiences. I mean, audiences find material all the time, too.
Right.
Yeah, so.
But there's so many choices now.
Oh, yeah.
The content wars are insane.
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, look at the podcast world, for instance.
If you don't get the right lead in, you've almost got no chance of attracting people to a brand new series. Very astute.
Sure.
We spoke
sure.
briefly about yeah. that. Here's another potential reason that you have been a part of shows not getting a second season. You're not great at picking material.
You know what's funny about that, too, is there's an illusion that...
There are 17 scripts
yeah.
to choose from.
Oh yeah, yeah. Okay. Kyle, here are the directors, and then have a go. Pick The Godfather. Pick
Throw
Goodfellas. Pick Pulp Fiction. I mean, and especially once you start a family and you've got a living to make, and you have, for instance, with TV shows, you got 2 months to pick a show that potentially could go or not go. And you're at a different time in your career every year. You're at a different, you know, there's years where I'm like, I am only doing cable dramas and let's just look for those. And there's the other year, I'm not doing any, I did a couple sitcoms last year, I'm not gonna do that. And other years are like, give me everything, I wanna make a choice. So I am always fascinated by the perception of an actor's choice.
Yes.
Leonardo DiCaprio, Clooney, there's like maybe 5 people.
Who get to choose.
And that's truthfully,
right.
you know, and it's like...
Jane Lynch got to choose our show.
I could
choose. Which is
choose.
One of the reasons I said
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, exactly. I could say, you know what, until I find the exact perfect thing ever,
yeah.
I'm not working and my kids would, you know, would
Well,
would
no,
be
you can,
around
you can
and,
know and, yourself out of a career. I point
sure.
to Sandra Bernhardt after King of Comedy.
Yeah.
The story goes that she just kept saying no to
no,
things,
right.
thinking... another King of Comedy will come along.
Right.
And if you're lucky enough to be in a great film, people come up to me and say, why don't you do another A Few Good Men? The answer is, why don't you shut the fuck up?
Right.
These choices aren't, we're not turning down the great ones
yeah.
to do the not great
right,
ones.
Right,
that
yeah.
reminds me of like whenever your brother or somebody,
yes.
said, you know what you need to do? You need to get on that Tonight Show.
Yeah.
I was out here as a stand-up for about a year and a half. My brother said, well, you know what you need to do? You need to get on the Johnny Carson
show. It's a great idea. I need to fill out an application with the president of Hollywood and tell him what I'm interested in.
Yeah. So we just answered you're not great at picking material. Here's another one. Your talents are being wasted in television. This person thinks you should be a movie star.
1986, when only movies mattered. Yeah. No, I mean,
yeah. Here's the next one. People watch a show you're on and want to punch your face.
I would say that plenty. I have a very punchable face. Yeah.
See, now I would say I had never met you before, and you showed up to our house. Sorry, something just flew my eye.
And you punched me right away.
And you showed up at our house. Sorry. By the way, unexpected. Yeah.
No, listen. There was not a party going on. I'm sorry. Something just flew in my eye in the middle of my sentence. I'm sorry about that. Excuse me. So we had a barbecue, and he showed up to the house, and I had not met him before. And he, just as he's walking up the stairs, I assumed, I'm like, this guy's got to be an actor because he's way too handsome to be like any one of our friends.
But yeah, that might be reason enough to punch me as well. There's a lot of people have different reasons for.
That's the point I was trying to make. Sorry, something.
No, you threw in a compliment when we were going down the other side of things. You enjoyed him in the D Train. He was one of the friends, which you had to lovingly remind me of.
Right. That's a great movie.
I loved the D Train. Yeah. Loved it. I've never felt so uncomfortable and laughing uncontrollably.
James Marsden. I'll give a pitch to handsome men. James Marsden.
Not fair.
I keep using the word underrated. Maybe that's not the right, but check out a lot of Marsden's works. He's a very good actor.
Underappreciated.
Yeah. Very good in this movie, in D Train. Yeah.
You are very good.
I am too, but Marsden as well.
And then the last reason maybe given as to the lack of a second season.
Uh-huh.
You've never co-starred with Jane Lynch, Maggie Lawson, and Kevin Pollak.
That's where I finally picked my material correctly. Yeah.
Here's hoping. No, but I mean, I really did. That was the phone call. Here's the pilot, read it. This guy wants you to do it. What do you think? And I said, who's in it? And they said, Jane Lynch. And I said, I'm in.
Yeah, oh yeah.
I mean,
Jane Lynch is as a irreverent, profane, would-be guardian angel.
Yeah.
It's just a great set.
And they give her such great licks and riffs and rhythms. It's almost reminiscent of like a Bill Murray kind of character is what I keep hearkening back to.
Well, and she owns her persona similar to him, you know, where she knows exactly how to...
She puts on a clinic every day at work.
Get the meat of the bat,
It's pretty great. And she's redonkulously generous and supportive. I want to talk a little bit about Dancing with Sigourney Weaver, if you don't mind.
Thank you. Boy, you bring out all the things that
big
I love about my career.
Big fans here of the Sigourney Weaver?
I'm a huge Sigourney Weaver fan.
Tell us how this came to be.
This was a movie called You Again, and I got that by singing a Soft Supply song in the audition.
Which one?
All Out of Love, maybe? They actually ended up rewriting the script to conclude the song in the movie, and it's even the night. It's either Even the Nights Are Better or I used to know all the Soft Supply. Did I say Soft Supply or Air Supply? Because I was in a band called Soft Supply.
You said Soft Supply.
Air Supply. Soft Supply is the band that I was the lead singer of.
Really?
Where we did soft rock songs from the 80s in a hard rock fashion. Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
When was this happening? This sounds fantastic.
We were LA Weekly's best cover band in 2002 or 2003. Yeah. I had a curly mullet and a brown leather members only jacket, and we would sing soft rock songs. You know, Coast 103.5, which is a famous soft rock station out here. It was basically the hits from 103.5. that everyone would sing along in their songs. I said, we should just do this live in a really awesome rock band version of it. And so we would do Bryan Adams' Heaven. We did a lot of Pierce Otero. We did a lot of REO Speedwagon.
Any way to get the group back together?
I only did it for one season. You know, I don't know how to do things for more than 1 year.
I mean, could we rent you for a party? Is what I really.
We haven't rehearsed in a while, but I wanted to end that on a high and then go out.
Where was the last gig? Do you remember?
Yes, it was a Hard Rock Cafe that's no longer there.
At the Beverly Center?
At the Beverly Center.
Wow.
On New Year's Eve.
Wow! Yeah. We had a New Year's Eve gig?
We had a New Year's Eve gig. It was a pretty good turnout. It was a lot of European tourists.
Interestingly.
So just us and some Onion Blossoms and
Eurotrash.
And Eurotrash. And there was about a 50% getting it rate from their, like, you know, they showed up and there's, okay, we'll go down and watch this band. And, you know, I don't know if they got our references to Do They Know It's Christmas and other 80s songs we were doing. But
it's like when Christopher Guest told us that the Mighty Wind opened up for Spinal Tap and Mighty Wind got kind of booed off.
Right, because they had...
the audience had
kind of... Mighty Wind, it was whatever that band, it's not...
No, they're not
band
called the Mighty
from
Wind.
Mighty Wind, which I forget was not. It's not the Herdsman. Herdsman is that thing you do.
Oh,
it's
the called, band, the folk band from like the movie that. Opened up for the band Spinal Tap, and they didn't
it's not
get
the,
it.
Yeah. What is it?
Folksman.
the Folksman.
That's it.
Have you heard the story of how he came up with Spinal Tap?
That thing you do.
How he was in a lobby of a hotel watching a rock band check into the hotel, and the guy forgot and the manager's like, "Where's your bass?" And the bass player's like, "Oh, yeah, yeah. I thought you had it." "What do you mean? You didn't bring your bass?" "I think it's at the airport." "You're supposed to bring it from the airport." He's just watching this weird exchange happen at the lobby desk, and that's where he supposedly came up with the idea for
Spinal Tap. Yeah, that's pretty great. Damn it. Why didn't that come up in the research when we had Christopher Guest on the show, J-Mac?
I'll see
myself out. J-Mac is seeing himself out. And now we get to the wonderful part of the show where you actually tell the story of Dancing with Sigourney Weaver.
Oh, yes. Yeah. So, you again, Andy Fickman directed this movie, and it had Jamie Lee Curtis and Sigourney Weaver as former... We meet these two girls that are rivals, two young women that are rivals, younger women, that are rivals who have to be reunited for a wedding. I think... Kristen Bell is a girl that was bullied maybe by this other character who is now marrying her brother, and they are going to hate each other for this whole wedding weekend. And the parents, Jamie Lee Curtis and Sigourney Weaver, are saying, "Oh, just calm down, it's going to be fine," until we find out that Sigourney Weaver and Jamie Lee Curtis were also rivals in high school, and they hate each other. And so it's a wedding movie where we have a bunch of wedding weekend stuff that we have to do. One of them is to learn how to dance, to do a series of dance for the wedding. And I get to dance quite frequently with Sigourney Weaver throughout that, as well as Jamie Lee, and well as Kristen Chenoweth.
And the experience, though, starts with you and Sigourney attending dance instruction,
right? And I'm an instructor in the movie, and I'm pining for Adet Yusman, who is my ex-girlfriend, and so it's a very complicated story.
So complicated, but no one went to see the film.
It's good, pretty well.
It did all right.
Well.
It did.
Again? It played for one season.
I remember trailers for this.
Yeah,
for sure.
It's like a PG-13.
What year?
It's Disney. Actually.
It's 2010. Not. Yeah, I was going to say probably like an edgy year ago.
It's not like an edgy hard R comedy. It
doesn't have to be edgy to be.
It's like a Parent Trap kind of.
Will you show your kids?
Yes. Yeah. I play like
that. After he shows them Willow. But only if you can find them.
Willow? Blu-ray. Yeah, well, I've already done that. By the way, they want to meet the guy from Willow.
So they can figure out who it is.
And anyway, so in this dance sequence where we're teaching them how to dance, I get to dance with Sigourney.
But you show
amazing.
Up at rehearsal.
Yeah, I show up at rehearsals.
Part of the job as an actor on this movie is you have to go rehearse and learn how to dance and learn how to be a dance instructor.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and also Sigourney Weaver is going to be there.
Yes, and I forget this beautiful woman's name now, but who is our dance instructor.
Linda?
Linda. So Linda we had to do a lot of dance training, actually, the whole cast. It was fun. So I was training with Sigourney Weaver and Jamie Lee Curtis and Chris. It was really neat. It was fun.
That was the part that I'm...
Yeah. And they were both great. I mean, I don't have any... I do remember her being better than I am. And we had to do, I don't know, what, marimbas or something.
What's happening now?
Yeah, exactly. And I wasn't good. And I remember the only... I remember
I
the dance instructor saying
merengue.
Better one time to me.
Merengue?
Yeah. Is it merengue?
Well, I only know that
marimbas
are
instruments, maybe.
Yes, a marimba, we had this argument on the way over here.
Really? You guys were arguing marimbas
and marimbas? Well, I thought it was
marimbas.
A xylophone.
A xylophone, but I was telling you the sound it was making was a marimba because it's a wooden instrument, and a xylophone is a metal instrument.
Both tubes?
Come on, people.
Anyway, merengue, I only know that because that's what they dance in the movie My Blue Heaven, which I adore. I love that movie.
Steve Martin. I made people call me Steve Martin when I was 5 years old for a whole year.
Wait a second. Jamie had a British accent when she was 5.
Really?
But you sounded like Steve Martin?
No, I made people call me Steve Martin.
Because?
Because I loved Steve Martin.
At 5?
At 5, yeah.
What had he done?
It was King Tut. And I probably saw enough of his stand-up that my parents would let me. It was that era when you would listen to stand-up on records. My parents had that. And he was on TV a lot from
Saturday Night Live.
From Saturday Night Live.
But as a 5-year-old.
Yeah, I don't think I probably saw The Jerk when I was 5, but
Well, the fact that you were watching SNL at 5 is already interesting.
Yeah.
What kind of household was that this was okay?
My parents were good at being entertained.
They liked being.
They're good at, we watched, you mentioned Moonlighting earlier, which was a family, the whole family was in the living room watching
Five
Moonlighting.
Kids.
Yeah. MASH was on the house a lot. Like I said, a lot of old movies. We're Singing in the Rain. It was my favorite movie since I was two, because that was always playing in the house. Some Like It Hot was playing in the house quite a bit.
Love Some Like It Hot.
And on TV, I just remember my parents being good laughers and being good, and it would always impart information. They weren't like buffs, they weren't experts, but they, like I said, I would know the name Norman Lear or Carol O'Connor. I would just know those names and then associate, that's the guy that's, my dad actually thinks he's funny, that must mean something that he's funny, and he was in something earlier. Oh, I should check that out earlier, because he was in this movie before that. Or say, hey, Kyle, I remember my dad very early on, he took me to Indiana Jones when I was six, leaning over and saying, that's Han Solo. I understood, oh, wait, there's actors that play different characters, and so.
What did your other siblings think of this?
My brother was similar to me in picking that up and then my other siblings didn't get into the industry, but they have a similar, they picked it up as well.
Three sisters.
Yeah.
And what do they make of you being in show business?
I think they find it pretty groovy. Probably not too surprised that I might have ventured that way.
Ended up here.
Yeah.
Right. Everyone's still pretty close?
Yeah, we're pretty close. We have our
close-ish.
Yeah, we have our family drama like anyone else.
And what about the Thanksgiving and the holidays?
Pretty good at getting everyone together. We're spread out a little bit, but I do have a lot of family out here. I shouldn't say I have an app idea. Not that I'm ever going to do it, but I think we need like a family concierge who organizes the families. Get-togethers and like organize it, because it's so hard, this is, I don't know if your listeners really want to know about my difficulty in scheduling, weekend getaways with my extended family, but
I think that's all everyone was sort of hoping we'd eventually get to.
Yeah.
But I do want to talk about a wonderful new podcast that you and your brother and the third
Stephen Kruger
are doing, called Movie Court.
Mm-hmm.
I love this concept. I think it should be a live show here at the West Side Comedy Theater.
I like that idea too.
I will offer up my guest appearance services.
Nice.
You just need to try to defend one of the horrible movies I've done.
I'm trying to think if you have any movies that would be eligible.
Oh no, they promise you there are several.
Well, they have to be on the bubble. They have to be. They both have to be kind of divisive movies.
I got me some bubbles.
All right.
Yep.
What?
So, well, we'll go through that, but explain to the folks what it is.
Well, Movie Court is, it's either me bringing up a movie that I think has been unfairly criticized or overly criticized and put into movie jail, and I bring it before my brother, who's the judge, Judge Ryan, and then Steve Kruger is the prosecutor, and I defend this movie, and then he has to say why it does belong in movie jail, or Steve will bring up kind of a sacred cow. Like he brought up Scarface recently. He'll try to slaughter a beloved movie bring up a movie why it might be overrated or overlauded and try to put it in movie jail, and I have to keep it out of movie jail by defending its merits. And it's funny. I came about, there was a couple movies that we would be just debating and having fun with over drinks that we thought it'd be a good podcast. But like Godfather 3 was one big one that I was always saying, I think this movie's over-criticized. If you change a couple things here and there, it's blah, blah, blah. And we had a handful of movies like that we thought of, and then we started thinking of more and more and put the podcast together.
Right. And how many have you done?
We just did, this is our first season. As you know, I only do one season of things, so this will be it. we've recorded maybe a dozen. We've posted eight or so.
On iTunes.
I'm learning the whole podcast world and how to be better about getting it out there, which I will, and I'm going to pick your brain on camera, actually, and they're going to have to listen to you tell me how to do it.
Or maybe just at work tomorrow.
Yeah. No, we can do it right here. we just started posting a couple weeks ago, and we've gotten a nice response, and it's been fun.
Is there anywhere people can write to the show
and make
suggestions?
Yes, and I would probably should have been better... You have like a scroll at the end that you can add to this, right?
That's right.
It's on the iTunes.
Well, we can get it to
site.
Natalie
it's
Rosen.
It's the movie court at something. My movie court at iTunes. How does that work?
Where you get the emails?
That's where you can.
You have to set up an email account.
Email to us. Yeah, there's a thing that's been set up. That I'm ill prepared to
there's
to,
a
to
thing
pitch.
That has been.
I like
set
my
up.
Things just being discovered.
Right.
Like my plan moving out to LA.
Yes.
Write my scripts in my room, and someone will discover me.
That's right. I had never heard how Ivana might have changed things for you, the Chubbuck, the famed instructor and author.
Oh, my, yeah, she's got
of acting. Acting. Does she come from a style of acting?
She has her own kind of.
Stanislaus.
She was actually a stand-up comic, I think.
Jesus.
I think she was, but and her. I mean, I've done a lot of acting classes with a lot of different acting coaches, and she was the first and was instrumental in getting me interested in acting. But I wasn't with that class for that long.
Any storied instructors that you had over the years? Jeff Goldblum, I know, follows.
No, he
on occasion instructs.
He instructs, and
somebody's
I've never
class.
Been taught by him, but he is great. There's a great guy named Alan Feinstein that is excellent, that still teaches. And Lisa Volpe, who's an excellent Shakespearean actress that I've learned from over the years. And yeah, I would like to put together I liked a lot of different viewpoints on acting when I was doing it. And I don't like teachers that are very dogmatic. Like this is, I mean, there's a place for that. There's a place for one technique, and sometimes that helps. That works for plenty of people. You know, just that one way. You know, but a lot of acting coaches will do that as a way to, you know, you have to come to me. It's a marketing thing, really. You know, but you know, there's often some value in a rigid, you know, technique like that.
Yeah, and I think any instructor of any kind that makes themselves more important than the curriculum.
That's what you have to be careful of. Too guru-ish she is what you just be on. But even if that, if you're smart enough to kind of know what you need and glean from, you know, like Ivana was a perfect example. There was a lot of her stuff and a lot of her approach that I thought was too guru-ish and too like my way, you know. But a lot of it that was helpful to me too. So you just sort of take and pick what works for you. And
and what did you find that was being taught that didn't work for you?
It was a lot of substitution in that, in terms of okay, what are you going for? Every single scene is about going for something, and if you don't have that, you're never going to get through a scene. And I would find that I could often
phone it in,
and hopefully the editors would just make it work. You know, that's been my approach. No, I would feel like there was other ways to get into a scene, but that an objective it can be useful. You know, it's like anything. You're working through a scene. You're like, what do I need here? And there's certain things I do every time, and there's certain things that I don't feel I need to do every time. And there, you know, it can be a kaleidoscope of techniques. But I would find myself being like, oh, she's pressing too hard on that. She needs to let him do his thing, and then. You know, it's like working with a director who's being, you know, that you want some room for. Let me experiment in this space a little bit. Let's all experiment. Like workshopping a scene with actors, or
right.
In some of the acting classes I've done that were more workshoppy, where you're just like, let's see this through, or let's cold read it. Let's just pick up the page. Hers was very much, make a decision here, make a decision here, make a decision here, make a decision here. Which
right.
is fine.
Right.
And I often will do something like that, especially with comedy, when you need to really hit a comedic mark. Comedy's interesting because there's a I find drama, especially drama auditions, if I get a drama audition, I'm like, oh, great. All I gotta do is
learn say the words and get the fuck out of
the
way.
Say the words and get the fuck out of the way. And help the writer tell a story. With comedy, it's like there is a goal. You need to elicit a laugh.
It's a musical rhythm if you don't play it.
And there's many rhythms. It can come from, and I like getting laughs places that weren't, you know, some of my best auditions have been when I got a laugh, something they weren't expecting, plus right. the laugh they were expecting, but the laugh they were expecting, they got it from a different way,
right?
You know, but that all is really going through the, you know, really putting out really precision, you know. Whereas drama, the target's bigger.
Right.
Honesty is the most important. Both are honesty, I think, are important for both the comedy and drama. And
well, some of your comedy riffs in the research are referred to as Bob Newhart-esque. Have you heard that before?
I've heard the Bob Newhart thing. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I've been someone that I watched get down. Speaking of what was on in the house, both Newharts. The later one, the 80s Newhart, was on all the. I mean, we watched that show.
His timing, very specific.
Oh, yeah.
It had a little bit of the misdirect behind it, which I have witnessed you do exceptionally well. Or the turn on a dime, the thing with the scene we just played where you're putting up a front and then you just break.
Right, and that was, yeah, I mean...
It's such a specific rhythm.
And timing, I think people misunderstand timing. Timing isn't like you go to school and you learn timing. everyone's timing is different. Like, think of Newhart's a great example. You can't really track his timing and his approach. You can't really, Richard Pryor, I always watch Richard Pryor and I'm like, why emulate Richard Pryor? Richard Pryor is gonna, you're not gonna like watch Richard Pryor and then do what Richard Pryor does. He's telling stories and he's just naturally funny. Or, but then you look at the old time comedy of, you know, Mel Brooks or something, and you think, oh, that's timing. You come here and then you go there. But Bill Murray's timing is much different. Look at Chevy Chase in the Fletch movies. His is real different. There's a fluidness to them. Steve Martin has his own timing.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's from doing stand-up, too, that everyone's timing. You can't like, oh, I got to do the timing like he does it. That joke's not working because I'm not doing the timing that he's doing.
But your timing will be influenced by the people that you enjoyed coming in, without question. I've made a reference that...
But you'll make it your own. It'll filter through your own thing. If you were, like, who was one of your biggest heroes?
But I think that's true of all art, that we're inspired by someone before us. Woody Allen, you know.
Yeah.
Huge influence. And I definitely learned the... But he got that from Bob Hope.
Yeah, right.
Early Bob Hope movies, you talk about a comedy clinic. Bob Hope was unbelievable when it comes to...
Do you still laugh at Bob Hope?
Timing. From the films. Mm-hmm. From his stand-up, he was a joke machine.
Yeah, yeah.
They wrote great jokes for him. But at his asides, the little under the breath throwaways, are some of the greatest, I think, comedy clinic stuff people should sit down and watch.
Yeah. And I think if you or I were to try to do that, what would be interesting to track is do a Bob Hope and contemporize it. And you can do that. And how useful it is to watch Bob Hope, because the timing of that and the colors that, you know, oh, this, he did this in a brown and this in a purple, and there's a delineation. There's a great Jim Carrey, I'm a huge Jim Carrey fan. In Liar Liar, he goes, right when he discovers that he can't lie, and he's walking through the hallway, and he's got to stop by about five people and tell the truth to them despite himself. And each person is a different delivery and a different color to the performance. It looks, on first glance, like he's just going crazy, doing crazy stuff, reacting. No, he does a different kind of lie to this person and reacts differently. He turns, and it's a completely different moment in lie and a relationship he has with this person. Mm. The precision of it, and you're like, oh, he didn't just come in and do this. Right. This guy thought about how to, there's 10 moves. It's like watching Walter Payton. It's like Barry Sanders. Like, he just did five moves. All different. He did a spin, then he did a cut, then he leaped over a guy.
I think I agree that so much of Carrey's work was so at times cartoonish or large or over the top or broad that you didn't, that he was underappreciated in his ability to find nuance.
Totally.
All the way through.
Mm-hmm.
Liar Liar, was that a Apatow script? Somebody interesting wrote Liar Liar.
I think Apatow wrote Cable Guy. But I think Liar Liar was written by that movie is good.
Yeah. Cable Guy might be one for Movie Court.
That is a great one.
Because that I find is a dividing line.
Yeah, I think it's gained love it more respect it. At the time. It had that annoying like, oh, it's dark. You know that annoying.
I thought it was fantastic.
That was, if I'm not mistaken, that was the first movie that he got the $20 million.
Yes.
Paycheck.
That Cable Guy was.
All the press.
And everyone was like, sure. Why?
Yeah.
But it's not going to appeal to the mainstream.
Yeah.
So that's why they didn't. I think that was the problem. They couldn't comprehend why did he get this giant paycheck or something that's not gonna
It got out in front of the movie's release.
And that movie has an amazing soundtrack.
Great sound. It's well directed. Stiller is an excellent comedy director. And it's Carrey's. You never seen a performance like his of that. Like he hasn't done something like that before.
Yeah.
Or since. It's a great, bizarre performance that he takes real chances in.
And there's some beautiful dark drama throughout.
Yeah, it's got a weird, it's got a message. It takes a turn at one point, but it works. It's not just out of nowhere. It's like, oh, this makes sense. He's a little upset. Like,
I would highly recommend it. Yeah. Author of Liar Liar?
Apologies if I get online first.
Paul Guy or Guy and Stephen Major.
Huh. Those two.
Mm-hmm. Again.
Guy and Major.
Guy and Major. You gotta love them. There's so much really to talk about, but we're just out of time, damn it. I gotta let you get back to your family. Mm-hmm. Like why you would start a theater company having had so little experience in theater yourself.
We did
The Curtain Box?
The Curtain Box Theater.
It's still going, right?
It is going, I have...
Is it back in the hometown?
It's back in Iowa now. Kim Kurtenbach, who was one of the founding members, revived it in Iowa, and it's doing very, very well for her. Yeah, and I have not done a play with them for a while. I liked doing it back then. I don't know if I'll ever do theater again. I'm a little bit more of a... Maybe, I might, I don't know. I'm such a movie guy that it's the space I'm comfortable in. It's a different muscle that...
Well, you either need a live audience or you don't. I mean,
I don't feel like I need that.
I think that's one of the huge draws, has to be. Look, for legitimate actors who have said time and time again, it's the only pure form of acting. TV shows, movies are truncated in tiny pieces that you do out of order, and you never have a real flow of a performance until you get to editing, whereas theater, of course, happens in one pass, and that's what allows it to be different every night. But the draw of the live audience and to live and thrive in that moment may be something every actor needs to experience.
Yeah, and when you do, as a stand-up, you know, I'm always sensitive to people that need that and don't, you know, and you know, it's, oh, that's it. You know, he's hemming it up. You can see that. You know, I think the sad clown syndrome. Well, you just made a documentary about
that. Oh, it's not important to talk about that.
You know, I'm always
just available on Netflix for rental and Amazon
Prime. Right?
Amazon Prime.
I did a three-camera live sitcom a few years back where it was, you know, getting ready for a performance show and putting it up, you know, and I've done plays
I enjoyed the live in front of an audience.
I liked it, but I didn't feel, I was different in that.
The sitcom thing, though, didn't you feel a sense of falseness?
I did, you know, yes, I was worried about that. Like all of us, there's been this big transition of, oh, geez, sitcom seems so big now, and how do I do that? I think when I became comfortable with that I could still do my thing and...
Feel connected. Truth.
Yeah, and there's actually a theory that it's the opposite, that you should go smaller on sitcom, but anyway, we can get into that on part two, kind of whatever. I was very worried about that. I could do my thing, I could go as subtle as I want, or as big as I want, and everything in between, and really have fun with that rubber band. But I just didn't feel. Some actors just love that ramp up and that tape night and coming out. And I just didn't, there wasn't a part of me that needed that or loved it. As a matter of fact, I didn't love having that specter in front of me all week. Like, this is all going towards this.
You know, right.
Because I feel like, I don't know, this is like a life thing. Like, I hate when I have something in front of me that I got to look forward to, and it hurts me living in the moment. Like, it's more of a philosophy than like a performance thing.
Mm-hmm.
And
I thought this would be the greatest job ever, and I certainly felt that way when I was doing it just last year on the show Mom. That rehearsing and the sense of play during the week and the script changing and evolving and then doing it live once in front of the audience, but you would do multiple takes of scenes anyways.
Sure.
As a natural born ham and as someone who'd been in stand-up for the majority of my life, it felt like it was the best of all worlds, but there was just this constant feeling of a false reality that was, even in that show where they were attempting pathos and achieving it on occasion, just this false sense of there's an audience watching. I mean, it's organically false.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas you can get lost, I think, when we're not making each other laugh, but you can actually have genuine moments in a so-called single camera show, because it's never a single camera.
Yeah.
Rarely. That feel like they're connected. You can play the reality of the scene always, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. Or did try.
It's wonderful that it's changed, because it's not like Cheers and Family Ties and all those movies and All in the Family and those movies that are, so this day, still hold up as sitcoms.
Stop calling them movies is all I ask.
So, did I just call them movies?
Yeah.
You know, they did look more like movies. Like The Grain, you know. You know, nothing, you know, it's the same thing. I feel like we lost the handle as viewers. It's a weird thing. I can't really put my hand, why at some point in the late 90s and early 2000s, we lost the handle as viewers and everybody else on that format, on the sitcom format. And it's been hard to get back because I'll watch All in the Family or Cheers, or, and then Seinfeld also, I think, had a big thing because Seinfeld was deconstructed it so much. You know, it was the beginning of meta and deconstructing and
purposely society. Big at times. Yeah, I mean, every time.
Oh yeah, there's Michael no Richards. To that. Jerry's practically winking at the camera.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's so I don't. It's what it got derailed a little bit, and but it's not like I go back to Cheers now. And I'm like, oh, this sucks. This is not reality, and it's big.
No,
it works. Cheers totally works.
Yeah.
Whereas some of the sitcoms that are today just don't as much, and I, you know, sometimes the writing is just as good, the jokes are just as good. They're just, and you know, just something's not. On all of them.
Well, there are two things that stand between you and the drive home.
Okay.
One of which is the Larry King game, which you may or may not know about him.
Yes, I know.
Okay. In fact, our own Maggie Lawson, who was a guest on this show, said, are you still doing the Larry King game? When I mm-hmm. told her that you were going to be the guest today. But one thing that has to happen before we get to the Larry King game is a new segment on the show.
Awesome. I love being
And I think you'll appreciate it once we get to the end of it. It might not seem so at first.
That's life.
Yeah. and that is where I allow the guests to ask me one question.
Okay.
Go.
Why?
All right. This segment can never happen again because... That was the perfect way to do it. Because no matter what the question was I had planned to say, that's a horrible question. Let's play the Larry King game. I had the whole bit worked out, and then you throw that at me, and we have a better result.
It's a profound question.
All right,
question.
Time for Larry King game. I was pretty much just fucking with you.
Yeah.
And also, I imagined Jamie sitting there saying, this can't be a new segment on the show. Where you ask the fucking guest to ask you a question, you idiot. I was going to say that's a horrible question. All right, so it's time for Larry King game. Now, do I need to reiterate the rules?
Yeah, what? Yeah,
it's our listeners' favorite part when I do this for the 247th time. So I want a bad Larry King impression. So no sweat on giving me a good one.
Okay, great.
Yeah, that's the best part of it.
Yeah.
And then it's Larry... Before he goes to the phones, he would look down the barrel and share something about himself
right. That
no one wanted to know.
Yeah.
So that's the moment I'm asking you to recreate.
Okay.
So it's about Larry.
And I'm looking
about,
down here?
Yeah, that's your barrel. And then go to the phones. And the name of the city is funny sounding that you go to. That's the button.
Okay.
So, bad Larry King impression. Larry shares something about himself that nobody wants to know. And then go to the phones.
And so I just say, okay, great.
Anything. There you are.
Hello, I'm Larry King. I often masturbate without visual aid. Let's go to Meredith in Fulton County, Kansas.
That's perfect. Mm-hmm. That, ladies and gentlemen, is how you play the Larry King game. I can't thank you enough.
Oh, thank you.
And yet I will try the rest of the week when we go back to work.
You've already done it.
Thank you. Now sit there uncomfortably while I wrap things up for the folks at home. Kyle Bornheimer, ladies and Jews. I asked, and those of you who are wondering, the family name was not originally Kyle Born Identity Heimer. I did bring that up. Oh, God. What's the matter with me? I've missed doing the show. That's all. We have some very exciting shows coming up. I probably shouldn't have waited 2 hours into the show to mention this as a way to keep people coming back. But Brittany Snow, the lovely and talented Brittany Snow, will join us next Sunday, followed by Don Cheadle. Brace yourselves. Upcoming shows will be Al Jean, one of the head writers of the 26-year history of The Simpsons. Probably
just
the longest-running head writer is Al Jean.
Just a small program.
I think he's booked for October 11th. I believe the following 18th is Keegan-Michael Key. Very excited about that. So follow us on the Twitter and the Facebook, and we'll keep you informed on that. I want to thank the Mike Duman, the J Mac, Jason McIntyre, the Corey Levin, the Jamie Foxx,
the
Kenny Chen. Hmm?
The first one.
The Natalie Rosen, the Samantha Ward, the Sean Casey, and all the gang here at the West Side Comedy Theater. That is it. That is arguably show 247. Until next time, and as always, get out of my face.